In the last topic, we discussed about the DNA preservation. So after we preserve the tissue, then the next step that we would want to do is to extract the DNA from the tissue. So the learning outcome of today's lectures is that after the lectures, you have to understand the DNA physical and chemical properties. So for this part, I'm not going to go into the detail as you have learned this in the cell biology and genetics. But I will give you one exercise for you to do, so to help you to remember those things that you have learned. And the most important part of today's lecture is to understand the principle and the method of DNA extraction. So the method of the DNA extraction is made based on the physical and the chemical properties of the DNA. So if you understand the properties of the DNA, then you can develop the method to extract the DNA, to isolate the DNA from the tissue. So when we talk about DNA extraction, and we already take a piece of tissue, so where is the DNA in the organism tissue? In the organism tissue, you have many cells. Okay. In the cell, you have a nucleus and you have other organelles like mitochondria or chloroplast. So this is where you can find the DNA. Okay. So when you do the DNA extraction, you only want the DNA. Okay. But you don't want the other things, the other component of the cell. For example, the protein, lipid, water, and other things that other than DNA. So in order to isolate the DNA from the cell, from the tissue, you have to know the physical and the chemistry properties of the organism cells. And you also need to know the physical and chemistry properties of DNA. After you have understand all this, then you can develop a method to get the DNA from organism cell. So, where is the DNA? So, if you look at the biological organization, so you have learned this in your secondary school already. So, you have the higher level, which is biophil. So, in this course, we mainly deal with the macromolecule and also the cells level. So, you already have a tissue. And in a tissue, it's made of many, many cells. And in a cell, you have different organelles. And for certain organelle, you can get the DNA. Okay, so it's DNA is a type of the macromolecule. Just to give you an overview. So first, you have to preserve the DNA. So we preserve the tissue and also its DNA. Then after that, you want to extract the DNA, the double helix of the DNA. And then we would like to do the PCR. To increase the amount of the DNA for a target region that we are interested. So we're not going to study the whole genome. We only study part of the genome. Then after we have many copies of the part of the genome, then we can start to do the DNA sequencing and review what is a sequence ATCG of the DNA. So this is just a revision. So you have a cell. In a cell, you have the nucleus. Okay. In the nucleus, you can find the chromosome. And the chromosome is a genetic material. Okay. In the chromosome, you can find the DNA. So for different type of the cells, you can find the DNA from different organelle. For example, in a plant cell, so this is a plant cell. So the plant cells is very different from animal cells. Okay, you have learned this already. And in the plant, you have the nucleus. Okay, in the nucleus, you have the genetic material in the nucleus. Okay, so this is where you can find the chromosome. Okay, so this is the source of the DNA. So this is a nucleus, what we call the nuclear DNA. At the same time, you also have a chloroplast. So this is how it looks like. So in a chloroplast, you also can find a DNA, okay? What we call the nucleus, okay? So it's a DNA ring. At the same time, in the plant cell, you also can find the mitochondria. So in the mitochondria, you also can find the DNA. Okay, so the nuclear DNA, okay, is separated from the chloroplast DNA and the mitochondria DNA. So when we look at the animal cell, so this is a little bit simpler than the plant cell. For plant cell, you have the cell wall. For the animal cell, you don't have the cell wall, you only have the plasma membrane. And similar to the plant cell, you have the DNA in the nucleus. Okay, nucleus, what we call the nucleus. At the same time, you also have the mitochondria. For animal cell, you don't have the chloroplast. You don't have the organelle chloroplast. So in the mitochondria, you can see you also have the mitochondria DNA. So generally, we can divide the DNA for eukaryote. Okay, we have a nucleus DNA, which you can find in an animal and plant and other eukaryote. For organelle DNA, for mitochondria, usually you will study the mitochondria DNA for animal. For plant, you will study the chloroplast DNA. So this is where you can find the DNA in organism tissue, okay, for different group of organism cell. So after you know where is the DNA, then you have to know the physical and chemistry properties of organelle cell. So for this one, you have learned this in your biology, cells, and genetics, so I'm not going to repeat. So make sure you know what are the difference between animal cell and plant cell. For example, the first one, the plant cell, they have the cell wall. Okay. For the animal, they don't have the cell wall. So there are a few other characteristics that you have to know. Okay, so make sure spend a half hour or an hour do the revision, and you have to remember all these things. So the next thing you have to learn is the physical and the chemistry properties of DNA. You also learn this in your cell biology and genetics. As for physical properties, you have to know the size of the DNA and the structure of the DNA and other physical properties. For example, whether the molecule is positive or negative charge. Okay. And also from the chemistry point of view, okay, the chemistry properties of DNA, whether the molecule is ionic or covalent, okay, and so on and so forth. You have also learned this in your cell biology and genetics. Please go back and find out what are the characteristics of the DNA, okay, in terms of the physical and chemistry properties. So just now we already discussed where is the DNA in the cell. What are the physical and chemistry properties of organelle, the organism cell, and also the physical and chemistry properties of DNA. So after you have done read all this and understand, then we can go to the method. So while we understand all this, then we can learn what are the principles, okay, of the methods that extract the DNA from organism cell. So those methods are developed based on the physical and chemistry properties of the organelle cell and also the DNA. So how to get the DNA from organism cell? There are hundreds of protocols. So different kind of organism or different kind of the tissue type, you require different protocols. Each protocol, okay, lab protocol, you have the step 1, 2. Okay, so some of them are very short, some of them are very long. It depends on the type of organism and also the tissue type. But generally speaking, okay, you can divide the protocol into three different phases. Okay, usually the beginning of the extraction protocol, all the step is related to the lysis process. Then the middle part of the protocol mostly is related to the isolation process, and the last few steps of the protocol usually is for the purpose of precipitation or purification. Okay, so for lysis is to break the cells. So you can see that the DNA is kept in the nucleus, okay, and the DNA also kept in the organelle. So what you need to do, you need to lysis the cell. So you have to break the cell to release all the organelle, all the compound, and also all the DNA within the cell. So after you have lysis the go through the lysis process where which everything is breaking apart, then the next step you have to do is to do the isolation. So the isolation means to separate the DNA from the rest of the compound. Okay, those other protein, lipid, water, or other compound that is not DNA. So you want to separate the DNA from the other compound. After that, you need to do the precipitation or purification. So you want to purify or precipitate the DNA so you can collect the DNA and then remove all the other compound. So this process usually is done in the medium, okay, in the aqueous medium. So when you do the extraction, you will notice that it's in the aqueous phase, so it's a liquid. And all the steps usually involve the mechanical, so it's a physical force. For example, if you want to break if you want to do the lysis on the plant cell, then you really have to use a physical force to break the cell wall. Okay, for animal cell, because they don't have the cell wall, so you can use the enzyme to lysis the membrane. Okay. So in each of these steps, you always can find either they apply the principle of the physical force or the chemistry reaction to each of these steps. Usually we can extract the DNA by using conventional methods. So it's a method that involves the conventional lab equipment that you can find in most of the lab, and also the very conventional chemical that you can find easily. And usually this is very cheap, and it's also suitable for the difficult sample. So you always need to make some adjustment in your protocol. You always have the opportunity to customize it according to your sample. Regardless what kind of the protocol or method that you use, they usually divide into three phases that we discussed just now. So for example, in one of your lab, you're going to use what we call the CTAP method. So this is a main chemical that we're going to use. Okay. So this is CTAP stand for this chemical. Actually this is a chemical which is quite common in the antiseptic. Okay. So and just go through it quickly. So you just go back and watch the video. The video is more detailed. Okay, so in the first, we just take a leaf and then destroy it. Okay, we want to, if it's possible, we want to crush the leaf until it becomes powder. Okay, after that, we just put the CTAP buffer. Okay, so this is how it looks like. So now all the leaf is dissolved in the CTAP buffer. Of course, you can see some debris of the leaf remains, but it's okay. After that, you need to incubate, so to make sure the tissue is properly lysed. After that, you're going to add a CIA. It's a chloroform. So what you see here, this is a CTAP. So now you can see two layers, and this is a chloroform. Okay. So after that, you just shake it, okay, invert the tube for 1 minute. Then you can see that the chloroform is quite clear, but now it becomes greenish. And the CTAP become clearer. So that means that the other components, the other compounds in the lysis stage, okay, so include the chlorophyll, protein, lipid, and things like that. already had been isolated and had been moved to the chloroform phase. So this is the isolation phase. Then in order to make the separation even more effective, the isolation more effective, use a centrifuge. So this is how it looked like. So the next thing, so now this is the DNA already isolated. So the DNA is in these phases, okay, and all the other compounds, okay, chlorophyll or other things. So if this is greenish because of the chlorophyll is here, and you also have the debris, okay, the remaining of the leaf sample at the middle. So the DNA is here. Okay. So what we need to do, we just need to transfer this DNA into the new tube. Okay. So after that, because the DNA is still in the aqueous phase, so we want to precipitate and purify it a little bit further. So we use the isopropanol, okay, add the isopropanol to the new tube with the DNA and also the CTEP buffer, okay, and then centrifuge it. Then you can see, they use the same machine to centrifuge, then you can see the DNA is precipitate at the bottom, the white dot. Then you can remove the remaining of the solution and then add the ethanol to wash this pellet, okay, this white dot, several times. After that, you can dry it. So after you dry it, you only have a tube with a dry precipitate DNA at the bottom of the tube. Okay. So for the whole process, it involves quite a number of steps, but generally you can divide, you can categorize them into three phases: lysis to break the cell, isolation to isolate the DNA from the other component of the cell, and purification and precipitation. So those are the conventional method. So and now there are a lot of the extraction kits available. So these are the commercial kit, which is easier to use, and they have a less number of steps, and the result is very consistent. Okay, and but because of this, this is also more expensive. In any case, they still use the same principle of the DNA extraction. It's just that they use different chemical and different technology. So the chemical that they use, usually they will mention roughly what are the chemical, but you don't really know exactly what is inside. Okay, for example, this is an example of the commonly used commercial kit. So you can see you only have a few chemical, okay, it's not as many as the other protocol, and usually they use the silica gel membrane spin column. Okay, so this is a technology that they use to capture the DNA and isolate the DNA from the other disc. So this is a tube with the membrane here. Okay, so the membrane will bind with the DNA, okay, during the isolation stage, and also will release the DNA after the isolation stage. So this kit is available for different kind of tissue. So some manufacturers, they develop special kit for different kind of tissue. For example, they have the kit for the blood, there's a kit for the yeast and bacteria, there's a kit for the molars of insect sample. They even have the kits from the environmental sample. So just give you the idea. So this is a CTEP method that we discussed just now. So this is a conventional method, and this is a kit, the commercial kit that we use. So you can see here, I didn't show you all the steps. You can already imagine there are a lot of the steps. But if you're using the kit, there are only few steps that you need to do. Okay, so 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 only. Okay, compared to this one, this is about 20 steps. So if you have only a few samples, then it will not make much difference. But if you have 100 or 1000 of the sample, then the kit will save you a lot of the time. Although the kit is more expensive, but of course, if you save time, you also save money. The time also the money. So during your lab, and when you watch the video of the instruction, make sure you identify, okay, the different phases of the extraction, okay, three different phases of the extraction for each of these methods, and also try to compare what is the difference between these two methods. Okay. So you need to remember always, regardless of what kind of extraction method that you use, they always involve three phases, which is lysis, isolation, and precipitation. So when you prepare for your lab, you have to list out all the steps, so by watching the video. And in your lab report, in your discussion, then you need to identify each of the three phases. So which one is lysis, which one is isolation, which one is precipitation. And also list out all the chemical in each of these three phases. And also list out all the instruments for each of the three phases and identify the mechanical force they use. For example, sometimes you use the heating block to keep the sample at 65 degrees Celsius, or you use the centrifuge to centrifuge the sample. So these are the mechanical force. Okay? And each of these chemical and mechanical force have their purpose, okay? In each of the phases of the DNA extraction.